Alrighty. So, we started conversion stuff yesterday. Okay, you guys got to practice a little bit. You're going to start today by practicing a little bit more. You will have a quiz over this next Wednesday, and this quiz will look like the worksheets you've been given. So when you get to a quiz, you're not going to be surprised. You're not going to be like, wow, this is totally out of left field. Like, I have no idea what this is. They're just like, oh, yeah, this is like what we've been doing. Let's do one of these problems together to get you warmed up, and then we'll give you guys some time. So I'm going to take a look at one of these basic multi-step conversions. A couple things I want to mention before I do that, though, by the way. This box circled in green here, I will copy and paste this on your quizzes and tests and that kind of thing. You never have to memorize anything inside this box. Does that make sense? Okay? Mm-hmm. So don't worry about that. And this red guy right here, that's the distance gateway, where if you're going from American units to metric or vice versa, okay, that's the one you're going to have to go through for that. So you'll often use that if you're doing distance problems. Let's go ahead. Let's take a look at 1.62 feet converted to centimeters. So we're just going to do this whole thing together, and then I'll let you guys work on your own. So step number one, I'm going to write it as a fraction. 0.62 feet over 1. Love it. Okie dokie. Now, Jameson, do I want feet in my final answer?
No.
No, so they've got to go. So that means what has to be on the bottom of my next fraction? Feet. Because that's the only way they can get canceled out. Now, what would be a good thing to convert my feet to? What would be, like, do I want to convert that to miles? Do I want to convert it to inches? What should I go for? Inches, right? Because we want to inch our way closer to the distance gateway. You guys see? Oh, my gosh. Really good. Really good. So let's convert that to inches. Now, notice how I'm writing the units first. I have not written any numbers in that second fraction because the units will just tell me where each number goes. Okay? So, Scurlock, do I put the 12 on top or on bottom? What do I do?
On top.
How do you know that? Right, the units tell us, like, oh, yeah, I know it's 12 inches equals 1 foot, so if the inches are on top, I guess the 12 goes on top. Boom. There go my feet. Oh, no, I can't dance anymore, but I never could. Anyways, do I want inches in my final answer? Okay, well, I'm not done then. And what has to be on the bottom of my next fraction? Inches, because I have to get rid of inches. What do I want to convert my inches into? Centimeters, right? Okay, so centimeters right there. So there's a 1 and there's a 2.54 because we're using this guy right now. Where's the 2.54 go? On top or bottom?
Top.
On top, right? Because the centimeters are on top and it's 2.54 centimeters equals 1 inch. There go the inches. Do I want centimeters as my final answer? Oh, I do. Okay, well, that means I'm done with fractions. I can put my equal sign. I'm going to multiply everything on top. So 1.62. Times 12 times 2.54. What does that come out to be, by the way? 1.62 times 12 times
2.54?
49.37. Great. And don't worry about where exactly to round for now. I'll give you official rules on that later. And then, Izzy, you might need your calculator, but what's 1 times 1 times 1?
1.
Oh, look at you, smarty pants. And Izzy, what's 49.37 divided by 1? You got it, okay. 49.37 is my final answer. Now, in this particular problem, I gave you a space to write your answer, but if I didn't, you'd be a model student and you'd box this up for me. Be like, hey, Mr. P, I want you to grade this. This is what I want you to grade. I put a box around it, letting you know. So, if you're at home watching this, I would go ahead and pause right now to get some good practice in. You guys here in person, let's go ahead and put a few minutes on the clock. Let's get cooking. So we're moving on here now that you've had some time to practice. We're going to take a look at our measurement notes here. If you're watching at home, there's a notes handout you guys can take a look at. All right. So measurement, what exactly is measurement? Well, we'll define that as a comparison to a standard. A comparison to a standard. And this is your friendly reminder, For those of you guys taking notes, notebook paper, I'm not going to grade your notes. You shouldn't feel like you have to write down every single word that I have up here. But you want to write down what I emphasize especially. And some people prefer to just write down every word. That's up to you. But it's a comparison to a standard. So we're comparing to a standard. How tall is something? How long did something take? How much does something weigh? But that's all compared to some accepted standard. Some accepted standard. Not unfamiliar or not dissimilar to the control group in experiments. We're always comparing back to the control group. In the same way, when we measure, we're comparing back to a standard. For example, a foot. A little history lesson for you. You guys know where the foot came from, the measurement? An actual literal foot, correct. Yes, some king's foot. I don't know the details because I barely know history of any kind. But yeah, so some king's foot, he's like, yeah, boom, we're going to measure our donkeys in that for now on. Tell me how many of my feet is in one donkey, okay? But here's the problem with that. What happens if that king croaks? Huh? Is the next king going to have exactly the same size feet? Probably not. What if the next king has tiny feet? What if the next king has huge feet? What if the next king is super young and his feet change size every year? What do you do with that, right? Like, oh, well, my donkey's like 37 feet now because the king is like 4 years old. Now it's 35 feet. Now my donkey's getting smaller. Like, okay, what are you supposed to do? So that's not a great way of doing things. Okay, we need to get something better than that, something better than a changing foot. Enter SI units. SI units. What are SI units, Mr. Pilcher? That stands for System International. System International. SI units. What does that mean exactly, Mr. Pilcher? That means there is a universally accepted standard for all math and science measurements. Keywords here. Universally standard for measurements. Those are your keywords right there. So across the globe, there are certain measurements that everyone acknowledges and accepts as the standard. So we got some L's, some G's, some C's, some M's. L's? Like what I take on my quizzes? So L is a measurement of what type? What type of measurement is that? An L? It is a liter, and it's measuring what?
Liquid.
Not necessarily liquids, but?
Volume,
yes. Volume. So liters are measuring volume. A capital L, they're always capital L, you'll notice that. What is G? What is that? What type of measurement? It's grams, which measure?
Weight.
Not weight.
Mass.
Here we go. Weight changes depending on what planet you're on. Mass does not. Degree C is Celsius, and that's a measurement of temperature. M stands for meter, and that is a measurement of length or distance, whatever you want to say there. Now, these four things, liters, grams, Celsius, meters, those are accepted across the globe, okay? So if you read a scientific paper from Australia, from China, from England, those are the units they would be using, okay? Or at least they should be using if they're using the standard international system. America units, okay? I want you to write this down. America units. I love America, okay, but our units are absolutely terrible. They are the worst on the planet. They are so dumb. They are beyond dumb. Here's how I imagine American units came to be. Hey, Bob, man. All right, tell you what, Dale. So here we go, Billy Bob. we have a foot. Now, how many, if we want to cut foot into little pieces, what do you want to call that? Inches? Sure. Now, how many inches are going to go in a foot? Should we use 10? Because that would be really easy to multiply by? No. That's way too easy. 12 is my favorite number, so we're going to go with 12. But why would... That's going to be so much harder to... I don't care! America! Okay? I love America. All right? Like, Buckeye football is coming up tonight. Oh, my gosh. I'm freaking out about that. I'll be wearing my Ezekiel Elliott jersey all day long, immediately after school is over. But our units are horrific. I hate them. We're not going to use them in this class unless it's to make the point that they suck. Okay? Because they're so much more difficult to work with. Yes, sir. Is that a question?
Are seconds the universal
For time. Yeah, those aren't so bad. But at the same time, it's like, they'd be so much better if, like, it wasn't 60 seconds in a minute, if it was 100 seconds in a minute. You know what I mean? Like, that'd be so much easier to work with. But for now, suffice it to say, these four are the big four that we will be using in this class quite a bit. It's a great question, though. So that brings us to this guy, SI unit conversions. We have these seven letters here. You want to leave a little space next to each one. KH, DB, DC, and M. Some of you guys may have seen these before, as King Henry died by drinking chocolate milk. You guys ever hear that? Yeah, so some of you guys are nodding your head, some of you guys aren't. That's okay either way. I'm going to blow this up a little bit because the writing was a little too small, in my opinion, last period. I'm going to blow this up just a little bit. So, what do these stand for? Well, K stands for kilo, K-I-L-O, and these are prefixes, okay? These are prefixes, so they come before the word. H stands for hecto, H-E-C-T-O. D stands for deca, D-E-K-A, D-E-K-A. Now, B doesn't stand for anything other than the word base, so let me explain this. If I were you, I'd just write the base right there. So that's your base unit. That's where just a regular old meter, liter, gram will be, okay? So that's just where your regular word will be. So on the far left, you might have kilometer or a kilometer. But right here in the middle, that's just where a regular meter would be, okay? That's your base unit. And then if you go back to prefixes here, D stands for deci, D-E-C-I. C stands for centi, C-E-N-T-I. And the last one, M, stands for milli. You guys have actually heard many of these before. One of these was a unit on your test, as a matter of fact. It was centimeters, and there's another one, actually. You're right about that. Milliliters. You guys remember that, too? Okay. Now, how do we work with these? You don't have to write that down. Don't write that down. You just move the decimal to the desired number of places. So let me show you exactly what I mean by that. I'm going to zoom back out here now that you guys got those tiny words written down. Okay. So let's say I want to convert 14 kilometers to meters. Well, here's how I can use that system. I'm going to start with kilometers because that's where the problem is giving me. I'm going to move my way to meters, which is a base unit. To do that, I got to go 1, 2, 3 spots to the right. So that's what I'll do with my decimal. So this is 14. Here's the decimal. I'm going to move 1, 2, 3 spots to the right, and that's where the decimal now goes. Hey, what number looks like it fits perfectly into these slots?
Zero.
A zero. So 14 kilometers is really equal to 14,000 meters. Uh-oh. Oh, man, I forgot I had that little typo in there. Nope, come here. Oh, goodness, I'm falling apart. There we go. 14,000 meters. 14,000 meters. So let's take a look at this one. So we have 56,500 millimeters, and we want to convert those to kilometers, kilometers, that is. Well, I'm going to start with milli, because that's what the problem gives me. I'm going to go to kilometers. So 1, 2, 3, 4. 5, 6. I have to move the decimal 6 places, and notice which direction I was going, to the left. So this is my decimal. It's right here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So now my decimal's there, and what number fits in that slot?
Zero.
Correct. So 56,500 millimeters is equal to 0.0565 kilometers. And that's all the time we're going to spend on this. You have a worksheet coming up that will give you some more practice on that if you want to polish that skill up a little bit. You will be quizzed over that eventually, but this one's usually fairly simple. And you can see why the metric system is so much better than American units, because you're just moving up and down by scales of 10 repeatedly. So that's why it makes life way easier. All right. So let's go ahead. Let's talk here. Let's talk about error when measuring. So some important things to note. All measured values contain some degree of error. Keywords, measured values, contain error. Okay? There is not a single measurement in this world that is perfect. They all have some sort of error. And another way to put this, and you don't have to write the second sentence if you don't want to, but anything that is measured has error. Measured has error. So, any balance, any stopwatch, graduated cylinder, ruler, like any of those have an error associated with them. They all have some sort of error associated with them. So 9.868 seconds. Well, Mr. P, that, you know, that sounds pretty exact, right? That's got to be exact. It's not, as a matter of fact. It is not. That stopwatch, even though it's probably a computer-generated number, that stopwatch actually estimated that second 8 at the end there. It's not 100% certain that that is an 8 at the end. It knows the 9, it knows the 0.8, it knows the 6, but that second 8, estimated. At some point, you always have to guess. That's why there's an error, because at some point, you always have to guess. So, for example, this graduated cylinder, we've talked about these problems before. It's a little hard for you guys to see in the back row, perhaps, but this is the 51 line, this is the 52, this is the 53, and our meniscus falls right in between that 52 and 53. So we know for sure that we have 52 point something milliliters, but we don't know how far between the 52 and 53 it is. To me, I'm thinking, this looks like a 0.6 or so, but I wouldn't bet my life on it. It might be a 0.7, okay? So we're not totally sure, and because we're not totally sure, that means there's some sort of error associated, okay? Because once you estimate once, then you're just done. There's some sort of error associated with the measurement, no matter what. And here's the rule. You'll always estimate to the 1/10th, the smallest place, of the device. It's all about the device. It doesn't matter who's measuring. It doesn't matter what you're measuring. What matters is what tool are you using to measure. What tool are you using to measure? So if you have a great ruler, you'll get a great measurement. If you have a bad ruler, you'll get a bad measurement, relatively speaking. So we kind of measured our desk there for a second. Here's something that I have heard before. I can run the 100 meter dash in 12.603548528655 seconds. Does anyone believe that? Yes and no? Unless it's like, no way. I have run a 100-meter dash that fast, which, in case you're a track person, you would know that that's nothing to write home about. Not very impressive, okay? Because people sometimes, the fastest runners in the world can squeak just under 10 seconds, so that's really not that great. But do you think that I know for sure the 0.603548528655? Do you think I know all that for sure? Because the very last number is saying, hey, I estimated that second 5. I'm not 100% sure on that, but I know this is a 5 for sure. Is there any stopwatch that is that good in the world? No. There's no stopwatch that goes down to like the trillionth of a second, at least not one that I got my hands on. Okay? So this is kind of nonsense. All this is nonsense. I have no idea what any of these numbers are. I'm not sure about that 0, but I'm pretty sure it's a 0. So this has meaning, this has significance, but beyond that, since I estimated that you're in the first place, I don't really know. I mean, I don't really have any idea. Okay? So that's how measurement works. There's always some sort of error involved. Okay? So that brings us back to the beginning here. That brings us back to this guy. So go ahead and flip back to this worksheet. We're done with our notes. And there are a bunch of other types of problems on this worksheet, okay? So we have some thinker conversions. Like a baseball player hits a ball 175 yards. How many feet did the ball travel? And the average distance between home plate and the wall is 400 feet. Was this hit a home run? So there's some thinkers there. On the back side, we also have some conversions of room items. So you can start measuring stuff like the table of meters, the distance to Easton. You probably have to Google that one or pull out a little MapQuest thing. The bag of sugar question, that number 2. You guys can take a look at this bag of sugar. That'll tell you the information you need, all that good stuff. So here's what I want. You don't have to finish this worksheet after you leave today, but you have to work on part of this worksheet for the rest of the period. Does that make sense? So you guys can choose what you want to do. You can use the rulers on your desk. You can grab meter sticks up here. You can focus on the front page with the unit conversions if you felt a little shaky on those at the beginning of the period, okay? You do what you need to do to get the practice that you require to be 100% successful. But which part of this worksheet you choose to work on is up to you. And listeners at home, you are good to go. Just try and knock out this worksheet, except for this last part with the room items. You obviously can't do that. Let's get her cooking.